Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa Allah. Ashhadu an la الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أما بعد. Brothers and sisters in Islam, our entire journey throughout this humanist experience has been centered on positioning ourselves to arrive at a point where everything and everyone besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes second. The scholars, they have a saying, "Kullu ma siwa Allah ba'da Allah," that anything or anyone after anything or anyone that comes after Allah is after Allah. Anything besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And since our entry into this world, we have been programmed to believe that priorities are based upon urgency and tangibility and accessibility. Our attachments to people, places, things gives us the illusion that because they are tangible and accessible to us in that moment, that they have the privilege of priority. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran about those who make the tangible things priority. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَقُولُ رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا وَمَا لَهُمْ فِي الْآخِرَةِ مِنْ خَلَاقٍ. That they are from amongst mankind, those who say, O Allah, give us the good of this world only. Their prioritization was based upon what was tangible, what was accessible to them in that moment. رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا. O Allah, give us the good of this world. وَمَا لَهُمْ فِي الْآخِرَةِ مِنْ خَلَاقٍ. And they have no share of the hereafter. Because their prioritization was based upon what was tangible, what was accessible for them in that moment. And it is not until these things are no longer, these things and or people are no longer accessible to us, that we realize that priority is based upon purpose. The purpose that that thing serves in our life. Not urgency, not tangibility, not accessibility. Purpose. What purpose does that person serve in my life? What purpose does that thing serve in my life? Whether it is money, what purpose does money serve in your life? If money is everything to you, then you have prioritized money over Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, you become a servant of your money. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, ta'isa abdu dinar wa ta'isa abdu dirham. Humiliation upon the worshipper of the dinar and the worshipper of the dirham. Why did he call him a worshipper of the dinar and dirham, which was a form of currency during that time? Why did he call them a worshipper of the dinar and dirham? Because your love of a thing can cause you to become a worshipper of it. حُبَّ الشَّيْءِ يَجْعَلُكَ عَبِيدٍ لَهُ. Worship, your love of something or someone could cause you to worship them. And your love of money causes you to worship it, so it becomes your Lord. You prioritize it, you give it priority over God. You give it priority over love. You give it priority over family. That has now become your Lord. As Allah says in the Quran, وَتُحِبُّونَ الْمَالَ حُبًّا جَمَّا. And you love wealth ardently. You love it. You'll kill for it. You'll die for it. You'll cross people who are close to you for it. You'll cut people off who changed your diapers for it. That becomes your Lord. But it is not until we don't have access to these things anymore that we realize that priority is not based upon tangibility, accessibility, and urgency. Rather, priority is based upon purpose. As the things that matter the most should never be at the mercy of the things that matter the least. Allah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to give you an example of this, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw one of his young companions, Jabir ibn Abdullah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was very fond of him because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was close with Jabir's father, Abdullah bin Haram, who died during the Battle of Uhud. And after he died, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam always used to check in with Jabir. How you doing? So one day the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sees Jabir and he asked him, "Hal tazawwajt?" Did you get married? Are you married? And Jabir said, "Yes, I got married." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked him, "Abikran kanat am thayyiban?" Did you marry a virgin or did you marry a matron, a woman that has been married previously? And Jabir said, "I married a matron." And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam istaghrab, "Why would you do that? You are a virgin. Why wouldn't you marry someone similar to you? Why would you marry a woman who has experience, which you would have to catch up to her experience? Why not marry a virgin to la'ibuka wa to la'ibuka? That you can play with her, she can play with you. Tudhikuha wa tudhikuk. That she can make you laugh and you can make her laugh. Life would be very simple for you." The innocence. The simplicity of innocence. And Jabir explained to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that my father died and left behind 9 sisters. I have 9 sisters. Left behind 9 daughters. And I hated to marry a virgin girl who was young and immature like them and would not be able to be much of benefit to me. Priority was based upon purpose, not urgency. Because if it was about urgency and tangibility, he would have married a virgin. But it wasn't about that. It was about purpose. What purpose does that woman serve in my life based upon what I have going on in my life? Ya laytana nafham hadha. I wish that we would understand this. And so out of the 99 names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which he has given us 99 plus names that the Prophet that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us access to, whether in his book or in the sunnah of his prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the one name that helps us to put everything and everyone in our lives in their proper place is the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Awwal, the first. This name, when we actualize its meaning in our lives, it sets a precedent of awwaliyya. It sets a precedent of prioritization. Helps us to prioritize who comes first and then who comes after. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَهُوَ الْأَوَّلُ وَالْآخِرُ وَالظَّاهِرُ وَالْبَاطِنُ وَهُوَ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٌ. هُوَ الْأَوَّلُ, He is the first. وَالْآخِرُ, And He is the last. وَالظَّاهِرُ, And He is the one that is above everything. وَالْبَاطِنُ, And He is the one that knows the world of the unseen. وَهُوَ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٌ, And He has knowledge over all things. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave us a deeper explanation of what Al-Awwal means and how we can take from that meaning and actualize it in our lives. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to make a dua before he went to sleep. Min adhkar an-nawm, min du'a an-nawm, from the supplications at night before going to sleep. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to supplicate, Allahumma anta awwalu laysa qablaka shay, wa anta al-akhiru laysa ba'daka shay, wa anta al-zahiru laysa fawqaka shay, wa anta al-batin laysa dunaka shay, iqdi anni ad-dayn wa aghnini min al-faqr. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to say, O Allah, you are the first, there's none before you. You understand that? Anta al-awwal laysa qablaka shay. You are first in my life. You are first in the creation of the world, meaning none came before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was the first. Laysa qablahu shay. There was nothing that came before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa huwa al-akhiru laysa ba'daka shay. And He is the last. There is none to come after Him. After everything perishes, after everything ceases to exist, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yabqa wajhu rabbika dhul jalali wal ikram, the face of your Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala, even after everything else is gone. Kullu man alayha fan, as Allah says in the Quran in Surah Al-Rahman, that everything on the face of the earth will perish. And the only thing that will be left is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Huwa al-akhiru laysa ba'dahu shay. He is the last, there is none to come after Him. Wa huwa al-zahir laysa fawqahu shay. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-zahir, meaning He is the highest, the most superior to His creation. He is the most superior. There is nothing above Him. وَهُوَ الْبَاطِنُ لَيْسَ دُونَهُ شَيْءٍ. And He is al-batin, and there is nothing that escapes His vision, subhanahu wa ta'ala. اِقْضِ عَنِّي دَيْنِ وَأَغْنِنِي عَنِ الْفَقْرِ. O Allah, satisfy my debts and save me from poverty. Enrich me so I am not poor. This is the end of the dua. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-awwal. He is the first and there's none before Him. His creation on a macro level or in our own personal lives on a micro level. There was nothing in creation that came before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is al-awwal. Laysa qablahu shay. And He is al-awwal in our own personal lives. Meaning we should never put anyone before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned in an authentic hadith, he said, "Kana Allahu wa lam yakun shay'un qablahu." That Allah was, and there was never anything before Him. فَلَهُوَ قَبْلِيَّ الْمُطْلَقُ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the absolute first, nothing before Him. And when we look at the stories of the prophets and messengers, we see human examples of men who chose to see this world for what it was and what it is. They were never diverted from the fact that despite the opulence and the glitter and the beauty of this world, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always came first. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran to say to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to say to us, Qul, say O Muhammad, to your nation, to your ummah, to your community, Inna salati, indeed my salat, wa nusuki, and my sacrifice, wa mahyaya, and my life, wa mamati, and my death, lillahi rabbil alameen, la sharika lah. All belong to Allah, no partner with Him along with that. No partner with Him in any of that. My life belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My death for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My sacrifice for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My salat, my worship for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. La sharika la, no partner with Him in that. And when your life and death are dedicated to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, everything in them and connected to them belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's a conscious decision to put Allah before and above everything and everyone else. In the life of the Prophet ﷺ, we can see this name manifest in his daily engagements. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said, كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يحدثنا ونحدثه, that the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, when he was at home, he used to talk to us and we would talk to him as a family. فإذا حضرت الصلاة فكأنه لم يعرفنا ولم نعرفه وخرج. She said, but when the adhan went off, when it was time for the salat, when he heard the voice of Bilal, when he heard the voice of Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum, when he heard the adhan, it was as if he didn't know who we were and we didn't know who he was. All conversations stop, all things stop, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes first. This is for our children to understand while you're playing your video games, while you're outside riding your bike and your parents call you in for salat. We say, just a minute, let me finish this game, let me finish this round, let me finish this level, because Allah doesn't come first in your life. You haven't actualized what it actually means to put God first. That means in everything that you do. That means that when someone is calling you to haram, you look at what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says first. Allah comes first. That means that when the woman is, when girls are peer pressure for you to take off your hijab, you look at what Allah says, Allah comes first. Not pleasing your friends, not pleasing your constituents. Allah comes first. She said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would sit with us and talk with us and converse with us. But when the adhan went off, كَأَنَّا لَا نَعْرِفُهُ وَلَا يَعْرِفُنَا, it was as if we didn't even know who he was, nor did he know who we were. We're in a conversation, the adhan goes off, we'll continue after salah. Allah comes first. Even when Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha was going through the trial that she went through of being slandered, of being accused of adultery, and when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala finally revealed her exoneration from the heavens, Allah revealed in the Quran that Aisha was free from what they were accusing her of, and anyone who was guilty of accusing her, then they will have a severe punishment in this life and in the hereafter. Aisha's mother, Rumman, she was so ecstatic, so happy that Aisha, her daughter, was finally cleared divinely from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. She turns to Aisha and she says, Ya Aisha, kummi ila Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam washkiri. Get up and go thank the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Aisha said, "Kalla wallahi la akumu ilayhi abadan, innama ashkuru Allah." Bas, she said, "I will never get up and go thank him. I only thank Allah." In that moment, Aisha's mother is happy. Revelation came down to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "You're cleared of all charges. Get up and go thank the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam." In that very moment, her tawheed kicked in that very moment. And she said, what? No, I don't get up and thank him. I only thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Putting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first. She put Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first. In that moment, her relationship with Allah's name, Al-Awwal, was being tested. And it is important for us to be aware of these times and situations when our relationships with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is being tested. When someone is asking you to do something that contradicts your relationship with Islam, people that you have in your life should complement your relationship with Allah, not contradict your relationship with Allah, not conflict with your relationship with Allah. People in our lives should complement everyone in your name and in your cell phone. People that you communicate with on a daily basis should be people who complement your relationship with Allah, not complicate your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You got somebody constantly tugging and pulling at you, trying to get you to compromise your relationship with Allah, constantly trying to get you to put them first rather than putting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first. This is a person that you need to remove from your life. Because they're not for you. Al-Awwal, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's name, Al-Awwal, we all find ourselves some point in time in our lives when that name in our lives is being tested. Whether sometimes it is at a job, and a job is asking you to do something that you know in your religion is haram. But you need the job. But Allah comes first. So what do you do in that situation? Do you give precedence to your job and what your boss is asking you to do? How do you feel after that is done? You feel horrible because you realize in that moment that I was tested and I failed. I didn't put Allah first. How many of us in our lives are guilty of that? In that moment, you didn't put Allah first. How many of us are guilty of going to ask somebody for something and we didn't ask Allah first? You're the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Awwal, you are being tested with that in your life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructs us in the Quran with the adab of putting him, the etiquette, the mannerism of putting him first, as well as putting his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam first, as it relates to how we engage with his legislation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تُقَدِّمُوا بَيْنَ يَدَيِ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ سَمِيعٌ عَلِيمٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O you who believe, do not put yourselves before Allah and His Messenger. لَا تُقَدِّمُوا بَيْنَ يَدَيِ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. Do not put yourself before Allah and His Messenger and fear Allah. And indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala know that Allah is all-hearing and all-knowledgeable. What does it mean, don't put yourself before Allah? Meaning, don't make a decision in your deen until you know the ruling of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger. What does Allah say about it? This is you putting Allah first. What does Allah say about this? The next time you're about to DM a brother or DM a sister, ask yourself, what does Allah say about that? What did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say about that? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man kana yu'min billahi wal yawmil akhir la yakhluwanna bi imra'atin illa wa ma'aha dhi mahram." That if whoever believes in Allah in the last day, then let him not be alone with a woman except that she has a mahram with her. You want to be alone with her? Then let her father be with her. Let her uncle be with her. Let her grandfather be with her. Let her brother be with her. Let a male representative from her family, if you truly respect the woman. Because in the absence of that mahram, in the absence of the wali, the violations are possible. They are probable. You're going to violate the woman. In the presence of the wali, in the presence of the mahram, you stay in your lane. There's a lack of, you know, accountability, lack of responsibility in the absence of the wali. But it is putting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, when he was debating with some of the tabi'een about making tahajjud tamattu', Ibn Abbas, tarjuman al-Qur'an, the interpreter of the Qur'an, he's living during the time of the tabi'een, long after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he's telling the tabi'een that they should perform hajjud tamattu'. Hajjud tamattu', as you know, there are three different types of hajj. Hajjud tamattu', which is the most preferred form of hajj, is where you go early, you perform umrah, you take off your ihram, you wait until the seventh day, the eighth day, Yawm al-Tarawiyah, the eighth day of Dhul Hijjah, you put your ihram back on, and you head towards Mina to begin your hajj. So you're essentially performing hajj along with umrah. That is the best form. That's the most preferred form of hajj. This is what Ibn Abbas is instructing some of the tabi'een to do. So some of them retorted to Ibn Abbas by saying, Abu Bakr and Umar, nahana an hadha. That Abu Bakr and Umar prohibited us or told us don't do it like that. And Ibn Abbas, radiallahu anhuma, from the first generation, this is a group of people who have been nurtured by the Prophet wasallam and the early Muslims, in contrast to the second generation, many of whom did not meet many of the early of the Sahaba. Many of them didn't meet Hamza. Many of them didn't meet, you know, many of the scholars from the Sahaba, the first generation, they didn't meet them. But Ibn Abbas was raised by them. They said, Abu Bakr and Umar prohibited us from doing it like that. And Ibn Abbas says to them, Wayhakum, woe be to you. Yushiku an taskut alaykum sakhratun min as-sama. I fear that a boulder is going to drop on top of you from the heavens. Aqulu qala Allah wa qala rasuluhu wa taqulun qala Abu Bakr wa Umar. He said, I tell you that Allah and His Messenger said, and you're telling me that Abu Bakr and Umar said? I wasn't nurtured like that. That's not how I was raised. I was raised, Allah said, His Messenger said. That doesn't take anything away from Abu Bakr and Umar, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger come first. Two totally different generations. Ibn Abbas raised differently. That's not to say take anything away from the tabi'een. Nonetheless, they are not on the same level. They are not the same. So the point that I'm making is these are just different manifestations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's name in the lives of the early generation of Muslims. How does that manifest in our lives today? How does the name Al-Awwal manifest in your life today? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told Abdullah ibn Abbas, giving him some pieces of advice. I want to show you his tarbiyah, his nurturing. how he was nurtured to put Allah and his messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam first. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to Ibn Abbas one time, he was sitting on the back of a camel with him, and he said to him, ya ghulam inni u'alimuka kalimat fahfadha. He said, oh young boy, I'm going to give you some pieces of advice. Memorize what I'm telling you. Understand what I'm telling you. This is a Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a man, an uncle having a conversation with his younger cousin. Or a cousin having a conversation with his younger cousin, excuse me. And he says to Ibn Abbas, احفظ الله يحفظك. Preserve the limits of Allah and you, Allah will preserve you. احفظ الله تجده تجاهك. Preserve the limits of Allah and you will always find Allah in front of you. إذا سألت فاسأل الله. If you have to ask anyone, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إذا استعنت فاستعن بالله. If you have to seek refuge or seek help in Allah first. That doesn't mean don't ask other people. It means put Allah first. Ask Allah first. You need something from the masjid. You need something from this one or that one. Make dua to Allah first and allow Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to facilitate it to you through his creation. But don't humble yourself before the creation. Some people say, oh, I hate asking people for stuff. You know why? Because you don't ask Allah first. If you ask Allah first, you wouldn't feel any type of way asking other people, because you know the only reason that you are asking other people is to open the door for Allah to facilitate it for you. I'm not humbling myself to you. I'm humbling myself to Allah. I'm asking you to see if you are going to be the one that Allah is going to facilitate it to me through. There's no humility in that. I'm not humbled by that. My humility is before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I ask him, oh Allah, bless me with a job. And then you go to the masjid and you see a brother who you know has, you know, employees, and you ask him, hey, are you hiring? You don't feel any way because you're saying to yourself, is Allah going to facilitate it to me through him? That's the only way that your dua is going to be answered. You have to go after it. You make dua for something and then you go seek the thing that you are making dua for. But if you start with the people, then of course you're going to feel humiliated. I hate asking people for stuff. Stop asking people. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He told me that sa'alta fas'alillah, that if you ask, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, meaning first. إذا استعنت فاستعن بالله. You need help, seek help from Allah first. This goes for our parents, goes for our children. Our children, although you guys born and raised Muslim, at the hands of us as your parents, you still have to embrace Islam on your own. You still have to develop a relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala independent of the relationship that that your parents gave to you with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You still have to embrace Islam. You still have to take shahada, meaning you still have to utter the shahada in terms of your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We uttered the shahada. Your mothers gave birth to you through us. Your mothers gave birth to you. We uttered the shahada in your ear, but now you have to take your own shahada. Meaning, you have to introduce yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, independent of your relationship with your parents. That's not something that we can do for you. And do that now before there comes a time when you don't have an opportunity to do that. Do that now. I'm seeing a lot of our youth in here from Philadelphia. You know the murder rate and what's happening in that city. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give safety to the Muslims living in environments like that. But our youth, man, they're picking our youth off. One, they're doing it to themselves. The police are doing it. I mean, like, it's like we are endangered species. But don't wait until it's your janazah and someone is standing over you praying before you decide to have a relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because in that moment, it's too late. Allah says in the Quran, حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءَ أَحَدُهُمُ الْمَوْتِ قَالَ رَبِّ رَجِعُونَ لَعَلِّي أَعْمَلُ صَالِحًا فِي مَا تَرَكْتُ. Until death comes to one of them and they say, oh my Lord, send me back. Give me another chance. Send me back. Let me give me another shot. Give me another chance. Perhaps I can do some of the good deeds that I neglected to do the first time. You only get one chance to get it right the first time. You don't get another shot at this. You don't get another shot at this. There is no coming back here. And we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He forgives us for our shortcomings. رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَا وَقِنَا عَذَابِ النَّارِ بارك الله لي ولكم في القرآن العظيم ونفعني وإياكم بما جاء فيه من الآيات وذكر الحكيم أقول ما تسمعون أستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المؤمنين من كل ذنب فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. Brothers and sisters in Islam, as we engage with the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Awwal, and we allow it to manifest in our lives by striving to be the first spiritually. In our spiritual endeavors and our religious matters, we strive to be first as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our creator, is Al-Awwal, is first. Allah describes the believers as such when He said, subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْتُونَ مَا آتَوا وَقُلُوبُهُمْ وَجِلَةٌ أَنَّهُمْ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ رَاجِعُونَ أُولَٰئِكَ يُسَارِعُونَ فِي الْخَيْرَاتِ وَهُمْ لَهَا سَابِقُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and those who present what they present of their good deeds, وَقُلُوبُهُمْ وَجِلَةٌ, while their hearts are trembling with fear that perhaps Allah won't accept anything from them, these are those who are foremost in doing good deeds. Then they strive to be the sabiqoon, those who are first. This is how Al-Awwal manifested in the lives of the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum. Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, أمرنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أن نتصدق ووافق عندي مالا فقلت اليوم أسبق أبا بكر إن سبقته يوما قال فجئت بنصف مالي فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ما أبقيت لأهلك يا عمر قال أبكيت لأهلي مثله ثم جاء أبو بكر رضي الله تعالى عنه يجر كل ما عنده فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ما أبقيت لأهلك يا أبا بكر قال أبكيتهم الله ورسوله فقال عمر رضي الله تعالى عنه والله لا أسبقه إلى شيء أبدا. Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we're talking about how the name Al-Awwal, the first, manifests in our lives religiously, spiritually, how we engage with our acts of worship in trying to be the first, the foremost. Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu and Umar, they always had this competition with one another, healthy competition. Umar said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded us to give sadaqah, to give charity. He said, and it just so happened that I had money at that time. وَوَافَقَ ذَلِكَ عِنْدِي مَالٍ. It just so happened to have money at that time. He said, so I said to myself, if I'm going to beat Abu Bakr in anything, I'm going to beat him today. Umar's thinking he's doing something. I'm going to beat him today. So Umar said he came and brought some of his wealth to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet asked him, what did you leave for your family, Umar? Umar said, I left my family half of my wealth. I brought half of my wealth. I left the other half of my wealth for my family. Good. Umar said, and then here comes Abu Bakr. يَجُرُّ كُلَّ مَا عِنْدَهُ. He's carrying his heavy bag on his shoulder with everything that he owned. And he drops it in front of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet asked him, what did you leave for your family, Abu Bakr? He said, I left for my family Allah and His Messenger. That's all they need. Here we are worrying about, you know, do I have any health benefits? Or do I have any, you know, money that's going to be left over to be inherited? If you inherit Allah and His Messenger, then you've been sufficed. You can inherit all the money in the world. Without deen, it means nothing. Without deen, it means nothing. You're going to squander it anyway. There's no barakah, no blessing in it anyway. As parents, we strive to leave our children Allah and His Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That doesn't mean neglect inheritance. That doesn't mean don't leave something behind for your family, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also said to leave behind wealth for your children so they're not out begging people. It's better than leaving them with their hands out asking of people who will either give it to them or not. So we don't take one text and abandon the other. We look at Islam through the whole picture. And Abu Bakr leaving nothing but Allah and His Messenger for his family and giving all of his wealth, that means liquid wealth.
Abu Bakr was a businessman. And as a businessman, you have multiple streams of income. That means that sometimes a wealthy man might give away all the money he has in his pocket, but that doesn't mean that he doesn't have money coming in the very next day from businesses that he has. Streams, multiple streams of income. This is Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. So don't get it confused that he gave everything for the sake of Allah and had nothing for his family. He was a wealthy businessman. Multiple streams of income, which means that he possibly has money coming in. What he gave was what was liquid, what it was tangible, because it meant nothing. He knew that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would give it right back to him. And Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, Wallahi, I will never be able to beat him in anything. He outdoes me in everything. He's the first. That's how Al-Awwal manifests in his life. How does Al-Awwal manifest in your life? What are you first in? What are you first in your life? Are you first to respond to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Are you first to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How does Al-Awwal manifest in your life? And in ending, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's mentioned in the hadith that there will be 70,000 people from his ummah. 70,000 يدخلون الجنة بغير حساب ولا عذاب. There will be 70,000 from the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam who will enter into paradise بغير حساب ولا عذاب, without any reckoning, without any questioning, without any punishment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, just go into Jannah. Your book will not be read to you. You will not have to stand in al-mawqif sweating profusely, either up to your knees, to your ankles, to your waist, to your neck. You won't have to go through any of that. Allah will simply say to you, go into Jannah. And as he's saying this in front of the Sahaba, one of the Sahaba wanted to be first. Ukasha ibn Mihsan. He stands up and he says, O Messenger of Allah, idu Allah an yaj'alani minhum. O Messenger of Allah, make dua to Allah that I am from amongst that 70,000. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, immediately he said, anta minhum. You're from amongst them. Another Sahabi jumped up and said, O Messenger of Allah, ud'u Allah an yaj'alani minhum. O Messenger of Allah, make dua to Allah that he makes me from amongst them. He said, sabaqaka biha Ukasha. He said, Ukasha beat you to it. It was one slot. He beat you to it. What are you the first in? How does Al-Awwal manifest in your life? We see opportunities and we let opportunities pass us by. Ramadan, so many opportunities has come up. Sometimes we pull up to the light. There's a person, needy person that's outside. You got $5, couple of dollars, some change right there in your car. And you let that opportunity pass you right by. Doesn't matter whether the person's going to use your money to get drugs or get high. That doesn't matter. Ma'alik, you have nothing to do with that. He is responsible or she is responsible with what you give them. You are the one that is responsible for giving. And we let opportunity after opportunity after opportunity pass us by. What are you the first in? How does Al-Awwal manifest in your life, brothers and sisters? So as we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Awwal, we also want to be Awwal. We want to be Awwalun. We want to be those who are foremost. We want to be those who are first. I would be oppressing you if I did not end with this last hadith, this last incident that took place, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he spoke on being the first to forgive. And as many of the hadith is da'if, the hadith is weak, where Ramadan is broken into mercy, forgiveness, and you know, supplication to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the hadith is da'if. However, nonetheless, many of the scholars do act on that because it is from minbab al-hasanat, from the door of, you know, doing good deeds and earning good deeds. But as we are coming now to the end of Ramadan, we want to make sure that there are no loose strings, no loose ends as we are exiting Ramadan. We want to make sure that we cut off all loose ends, making sure that we've forgiven anybody that we've wronged, that we've forgiven anybody that, listen, you know, it's not about you, it's about me. I need to forgive you. Not because I want you to feel like you're off the hook for what you did, but I don't want to keep carrying you. Carrying you is a burden. Resentment is a burden. I don't want to keep resenting you. I don't want to keep disliking you. I don't want to keep hating you. But what I want to do is I want to let me go from you. I want to cut me off from you. Forgiveness is about you, not about the other person. Sometimes we don't want to forgive because we think that if we forgive, this person think they got it all for me. This person think they're getting away with it. It's not you to punish. That's not your job. That's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to hold them accountable. Not you. And most of the time, what a person took away from you, even if you are able to get retribution, it will still never restore what they took from you. Only Allah can do that. That's why his name is Al-Jabbar, the one who fixes you when you're broken. There's nobody that can repair you. Yeah, you can scheme and do everything that you can to get back at the person. But what is the sense in that? How much energy do you waste in doing that? How much time do you invest in doing that? And even after you feel like you've achieved your goal, you still can't get back what was taken from you. The human being, the God complex that we live with. Forgive. Don't you want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive you? Forgiveness is not about the other person. It's about you. You letting the burden down. You cutting yourself off from that person. I'm not carrying you anymore. You did what you did. I forgive you. However, you have to answer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that. And I pray that Allah forgive you for that as well. But you are under his decision at this point. I'm done with you. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, لا يحل المسلم أن يهجر أخاه فوق ثلاثة يلتقيان فيعرض هذا عن ويعرض هذا وخيرهما الذي يبدأ بالسلام هو الأول. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said that it is not permissible for a Muslim to avoid his brother or his sister Muslim for more than 3 days. This is for personal reasons. Obviously, you could boycott an individual until يوم القيامة if you are afraid that that person is going to affect you in your deen. That is preservation of your religion. But as it relates to personal matters, this person upset you, this person backbit you, this person did this to you, this person did that to you, 3 days. That's it. 3 days. To go beyond that, you have transgressed the boundaries. You are the oppressor. You are the zalim because you went beyond the 3 days. Get over it. 3 days. 72 hours, you can't get over it? You can't get over it in 3 days? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said it is not permissible for a Muslim to boycott his brother Muslim for more than 3 days. They meet each other, this one turning away from that one, this one turning away from that one. He said, وَخَيْرَهُمَا أَلَّذِي يَبْدَأُ بِالسَّلَامِ And the best of the two is the first one to give the greeting of salam. Al-awwal, the first. The best of the two is the one that initiates the greeting of salam. Because that person has shown that they are bigger than the situation. That although you upset me, although you angered me, I'm still going to give you your haq as a Muslim. You understand? That shows spiritual maturity, which many of us are severely lacking in. And we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he forgives us for our shortcomings. We pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from us our fasting, our dua, our ibadah, our worship during this month. We pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes what is left of this month, what is good for us in this life as well as in the hereafter. We pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows us to meet or see Laylatul Qadr, to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Laylatul Qadr. Ameen. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار اللهم أصلح لنا ديننا الذي هو عصمة أمرنا وأصلح لنا دنيانا التي فيها معاشنا وأصلح لنا آخرتنا التي فيها معادنا واجعل الحياة زيادة لنا في كل خير واجعل الموت راحة لنا من كل شر برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم اللهم صل وسلم وزد على نبيك محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وآخر دعوانا عن الحمد لله رب العالمين وأقم الصلاة